Doug says, from your deep dive into nicotinamide riboside NMN, do you think either is effective and is one preferred over the other? Do you still recommend taking TMG with NR? Yeah, so let me back up a little bit here. So these are all different forms of niacin. And in the anti-aging community, many people are taking nicotinamide riboside, which is NR, or nicotinamide mononucleotide, which is NMN. And the question is one of those better than the other? And then he asks me, do I still recommend taking trimethylglycine or TMG with NR because extra niacin depletes methylation, depletes methyl groups, and TMG is a methyl donor? So yeah, there are no human studies looking at NMN and how it's metabolized, like, and there are studies of NR. No one has showed any positive benefits of supplementing NR in humans yet, but they haven't really done any long-term studies or looked at many things, and they really haven't looked at anything that I would really want to see for NR. They've looked at things like, you know, glucose and lipids and other metrics of metabolic health. Doesn't really do anything for that. I know Charles Brenner is doing a study on fatty liver. I bet you, I don't want to bet money on it. I would bet like, I'm not really a betting man, but I'd be willing to bet like $200 or $300 on 3-to-1 odds that he doesn't show the benefits on fatty liver that he's expecting to, because the overwhelming thing about fatty liver is methyl donors. And he's published 2 papers showing that nicotinamide riboside causes an extreme increase in methylated niacin metabolites, like extreme increase. So when they're feeding people 2,000 milligrams of nicotinamide riboside, I don't know what portion is being methylated and peed out in the urine, but I know it's very high. So this is what I would say. My strong suspicion is that NMN is not absorbed intact. It's broken down into NR. And it's absorbed intact as NR, while NR is just absorbed intact in NR. And I believe that both of those supplements are going to lead to NR getting into the liver. And so, I mean, I would use NR because there's more data on NR. And I wouldn't use NMN because there isn't any data on it. But it probably makes no difference at all because they're probably both absorbed as NR. Maybe if your digestion is weaker, you're going to do better with NR than NMN because you probably almost certainly are not absorbing NMN intact. And if you're not digesting it, then you're absorbing less of it. But probably for most people, it makes no difference. I believe that both of these are going to generate NAD levels in the liver much more effectively than nicotinic acid or niacinamide would, the two common niacin supplements that are available on the market now and have been taken for ages. I think it'll be better at boosting NAD levels in the liver. And I think that will allow the liver to nourish many other tissues in the body to get a better NAD response in those tissues. My suspicion is that this is going to have a positive effect for anti-aging, for cellular repair. I think it's probably going to have a lot of promise for effects, mental effects in the brain, where there's high NAD turnover for neurotransmitter release. I think it's going to have probably real good effects in the gut, where there's high NAD turnover because the gut faces so much damage by just being forced to deal with everything that you put into your body, unlike everything after the gut, after absorption, which has really high quality control. And I think it's going to be great for skin issues. Peter Attia told me in our recording that his patients who are taking it, the one thing that people report positive benefits with is rosacea. I think anything in the skin is going to be great for nicotinamide riboside and maybe NMN have a lot of promise just to improve cellular repair in the skin. And I don't know for sure, but I'm going to guess that maybe if there's another tissue after the brain, gut, and skin that have a lot of benefit, it's going to be the lungs. But that's a wild guess on my part. And so this is a bit speculative. It looks good in animals so far. I'm speculating that we're going to see these benefits if we do longer term studies in humans, but I think we will. In terms of the dose, I think when we get good data in humans, we're going to roll back the dose. I think 2,000 milligrams is just taxing the methyl supply too much. And most people are not consuming enough methyl donors in their diet to compensate for that. And so I think at some point we're going to, you know, when in 10 years when we have a lot more data, we're going to say, yeah, that, like, let's pull the dose back to like 300 milligrams. I think that in order to maximally retain, in order to get the best NAD response and to tax the methylation system the least, you want to take a smaller dose with every meal rather than taking a higher dose once. So I would take like 150 milligrams max at a meal. And if you're going to take 750 milligrams, I'd take 150 at each of three meals. If you want to take less than that, I'd either use the powder or empty half of it out in a capsule. You know, like take half the capsule, empty it out into your mouth with a meal. 150 milligram capsule, do that. It'll give you 75 milligrams. Take that three times a day. And then, you know, there's no good test to really see whether it's doing anything for you. So you really have to judge it by your response. You know, are you getting tangible benefits from it? If so, then I think it's fine to keep it up. But yeah, I would take 100 milligrams of TMG for every 200 milligrams of nicotinamide riboside or nicotinamide mononucleotide. And I personally, I wouldn't use the NMN, I'd use the NR because there's more data on it. Thanks, Doug.